talking on Decentering the Human, Posthumanism, and the Anthropocene.
I'm very excited to be here with you. We are talking about something very important today, so this is a wonderful convention to do that. My name is Francesca Ferrando. I teach philosophy at the program of Liberal Studies at NYU. In the public, there is some of my wonderful students. Thanks for being here with me. And I'm also a philosopher of the posthuman, and you can find more information about me at this website, theposthuman.org. I'm also part of the New York Posthuman Research Group. So whatever we can do together, we are going to do together in the second part of my talk. So this talk is divided in two parts. The first part is more theoretical. We're going to talk about posthumanism, the Anthropocene. And in the second part of the talk, we're going to do more like a workshop and try to envision possible futures together. So my talk is, the title is Decentering the Human, Environmentalism, Posthumanism, and the Anthropocene. We're talking today about one of the most important challenges we are currently facing as a species, as individuals, as moral, ethical, and social beings, as people who have families, extended families, as individuals who care about the future, because we know that the future is already present. It is here now, in our acts, in our visions, in our behaviors, in our words, in our dreams, in what we eat, in what we drink, in what we produce, in what we buy, in what we recycle, and in what we do not recycle, our bright future. This is an installation, art installation, that was done at during the New York Climate March, and it's entitled The Dawn of the Anthropocene, and this is beautiful, bright letters made out of ice. And the title and the letters form this beautiful sound, which is the future, our bright future. Our bright future and our thin future that is melting little by little in our lovely hands. And this is what is left of the future after a couple of days in New York, is the F, the trunk of the letter F. F of the future, F of flow, F of fluxus, F like a flower. And this F speaks to me directly. F is the start, it's the first letter of my name and of my surname. And I'm here now talking to you about us. I'm a philosopher of the posthuman. And my goal is to envision desirable futures for humans and non-humans alike. In order to envision the future, we first need to know our present. In the 21st century, the impact of anthropocentric habits on Earth is becoming so massive that geologists are addressing the present era as the Anthropocene, an era in which human actions are directly affecting the ecosystem. So by the way, Anthropocene comes from Greek anthropos, which means human. And anthropocentrism, we're going to talk about later, it means this approach in which the human is placed at the center, okay? So this era in informal geological times is called the Anthropocene, which will come after the Holocene. And this is the era we're living now. And actually, I look at this audience now, and I see mostly humans, some hiddenly posthuman and cyborgs at length, but we're mostly humans here. So this is us, this is our era. So I would say welcome to the fabulous era of the Anthropocene. So let's dive into it together. And everyone is welcome, humans and non-humans alike. I will start our journey in Europe. Okay, well, I guess it's not a great idea to dive there. I'm originally from Italy. I wanted you to take you to some exotic place outside of New York. But this does not look like the best place for a refreshing dive. No problem. This is a big planet. We can certainly go somewhere else. And I'm taking you instead to this lovely river in India, blessed by centuries of spiritual ceremonies. Would you like to come with me? Yeah? Let's go to India then. All right. That doesn't look great either. Yeah. Okay, so until some years ago, this used to be made of clean water. I guess everything changes. To God Heraclitus, Pantarei, everything flows. You cannot step twice into the same river, as you can see here. And the river has a lifespan too. Well, no problem. Let's stay local. It seems like the best option. We are not going to pollute the air by flying too far. So let's go west, to a warmer place. California Dreaming, remember the song? What about diving into our beautiful California? That should be easy. The same country. What about California? Should we go to California? Yeah? You happy? Let's go to California. All right. Oh my God. Well, this is not really appealing either. Okay, do not panic. Do not panic. I've invited you to a journey, and I promise I will take you somewhere beautiful, where you can dive peacefully, meditate, and not worry about garbage. So let's go to Morocco, an incredible land with very kind people. I love Morocco, by the way. Oh my God. Okay. I get it. We cannot change location. The planet is one. We need to change mentality in order to dive into some more promising time. These pictures that we have seen come from the era of the Anthropocene. In the past, humans were not recognized as agents directly causing climate changes. It is now common knowledge that the Earth is collapsing under the massive quantity of non-recycled garbage, the high emission of atmospheric greenhouse gases, and the level of pollution introduced daily into our natural environment. So these are some of the problems related to the Anthropocene. We're talking about global warming, deforestation, pollution, extinctions and reduction of biodiversity, population overgrowth, ecosystem loss, etc., etc. So the way the majority of human societies are currently performing their interaction are leading to a point of no return in ecological and sustainable terms. This picture is based on the documentary Human Footprint and represents the amount of products consumed by an American citizen in a lifetime and the impact it has on the environment. Trying to live a sustainable life. I rarely buy prepared food and I use reusable shopping bags. And still, at the end of the week, I have two big bags full of plastic garbage. My salad comes in plastic. My yogurt comes in plastic. My raspberry comes in plastic. My salt comes in plastic. My mind comes in plastic sometimes. My ideas come in plastic. Everything comes in plastic. So this needs to change. This really needs to change. As a philosopher, I study reality, not just to study it, but to change it. And in my study, I understood something very important that I would like to share with you right now, in the moment of creation. Because each moment of our existence will recreate the world, and nothing will ever be the same. Because in the cosmic dance of existence, everything is actually related and potentially interacting. Because we need a change. We need a paradigm shift. We need a new episteme, a new cultural model. What we've seen in these pictures is not a problem. These are only the symptoms. We need to address the cause. So what is the cause that brought us to an ecological crisis? What is the cause that brought us to the Anthropocene? The cause is anthropocentrism, a philosophical viewpoint according to which human beings are at the center or are the most significant entities. A reductionist mindset which allows us to view nature as a standing reserve, to use Heidegger words. Human-centrism, you can also, again, anthropocentrism comes from Greek, you can think of human-centrism if it's easier. Basically, it's the idea of having the humans at the center of your world, of what is important, is the human. It's like in a hierarchical scale, you would have the human at the very top, okay? And that's also, of course, is based on religious idea, in which the human is created on the image of God. So you have the human at the very top of the ladder, the Gretchen of being, think of the Gretchen of being. So this kind of episteme, anthropocentric, invites us to see humans as unique, in an ontological void, above all the other species. Humans, the most intelligent ones. How many times have you heard this? How many movies have you seen saying the humans are the most intelligent ones? How many documentaries talk about the humans as the most evolved ones? But how can you talk about evolution in a progressive way? Evolution is about diversity, it's about diversification. It's not about being the best or the most evolved ones. It's not a game in which I'm winning because I'm the most evolved being. So we see ourselves as the masters of the environment, the self-sustaining creatures in existential monologues. So this is anthropocentrism, and this is the fabulous era of the Anthropocene. But we're in America, the land of love, the land of hope. And we know that yes, we can. We can make a change. We are making a change right now in how we act. For instance, the fact that this microphone and this entire festival is powered only by wind energy is a great achievement. And we are making a change right now in the way we speak, by bringing posthumanism into the discussion. Because in the beginning was the word, as written in the Bible. Words constitute our social narratives. Words are not innocent. Words create words. Humanism, with its emphasis on human exceptionalism, in which the human are the most exceptional one, may not be of help in changing direction. Posthumanism, on the other hand, can be the turning point. So what is posthumanism? Posthumanism can be defined broadly as a post-slash-humanism, a post-slash-anthropocentrism, and a post-slash-dualism. When thinking about post-humanism, it's the idea that human is not one, but many. Look at us, how many of the diversity of humans we have here now, so the human cannot be centralized in one idea of the human. Post-anthropocentrism is the idea that the human species is not at the center of anything. We are in a symbiotic existence with many other species. And post-dualism is the idea that existence is not created by a dual entity. So it's not that are male against female, or black against white, hetero slash gay, or east slash west. It's a post-dualistic approach in which the human, we don't think of the human as created by the non-human, which has been done historically. So what is the human is created by the non-humans. So we are humans because we are not a dog, or we are not a plant. But this type of approach is a post-dualism. So it's more about the multitude and the diversity. It's not about having a simple dualism there. Okay, so first of all, let me tell you that posthumanism is something you want to know about. Why? Posthumanism addresses the question, who am I? Or philosophical question, is the base of philosophy, in conjunction with other related questions, such as, what am I? And where and when are we? The existential aspects are not disjunct to political and spatiotemporal elements. There is no absolute other. So there is not, you're not separated from others. There is no absolute otherness. We exist in a material net in which everything is actually connected and potentially interactive. Such an awareness generates theoretical as well as pragmatic considerations. For instance, how should we address the Anthropocene? The Anthropocene can only be addressed with a cultural shift, a passage from humanism to posthumanism. Posthumanism criticizes anthropocentric humanism and opens its inquiry to non-human life. Posthumanism calls for environmentalism, deep ecology, animal rights, and robo-ethics. The posthuman refusal of the ontological primacy of human existence invites a review of practices such as uncritical omnivorism, so when you can eat anything, no matter what, no matter how, so over-harvesting, and the unrestricted consumption of non-renewable resources. Posthumanism reflects on the terms of human sustainability, but it does not dismiss the significance of human survival. Posthumanists share many points in common with deep ecology, but it does not support biocentrism. And it opens its lens to non-physical entities, virtuality, and the digital era. So technology is totally fine, but we need a sustainable technology. We need an environmental friendly technology, okay? Posthumanism deconstructs any ontological hierarchy. Think again about the human at the top and then the non-human animals and you go lower and lower. So there is no hierarchy in the post-human. A multidimensional network depicts more closely what is at stake, and there is no representational autonomy. Think again, the words make the words. My pronunciation is not really the best one, but this was the slides. Words create words. The way the physical realm is conceived, described, and perceived is not separated to the ways it is becoming. Since the projection of such forms is simultaneously affecting the sensitive, interconnected, vibrational body of space-time. Now we're going to a last part. It is a little philosophical, related to quantum physics, and then we go back into a more like political talk. Okay, where? What? How? Existence is entangled, symbiotic, hybrid. There are no clearly defined borders which allow fixed notions of being. The way matter appears on the large scale might be misleading if taken in its ultimate state. Think on a subatomic level, everything is in constant vibration. As famously demonstrated by Einstein in 1905, matter and energy are equivalent. Energy is intrinsically relational, as well as matter is irreducible to a single determined entity. From a physics perspective, anything which has mass and volume is considered matter. Matter. Humans, all of us for instance, are made out of matter, as well as roses, as well as dead plants, as well as robots, as well as disco computer. Everything is made of matter. So, let's now go back to the question, who am I? Now think in this material network, who am I? We are material networks of relations, fluctuating becomings in symbiotic interactions with the others, plural, the environment, our surroundings. We are constant potentials. In Nietzschean terms, we are a bridge. Human existence is related to any other form of existence. Nothing in this dimension is completely autonomous or totally independent. We literally become what we eat, what we think, what we breathe, what and who we connect to. More than an exchange, ex comes from Latin meaning out, it is an intrachange, a fluid entanglement of being, a fractal movement of energy. We will have simultaneously affected your existence as well as the evolution of space-time. This is why I think a post-human paradigm shift is necessary in order to realize a post-anthropocentric society, fully aware that ecology is not separated from the human. Eco/logy, ecology, comes from Greek, oikos, house, and logos, the discourse on the space we inhabit. And talking about the space we inhabit, we live in New York, so why not talking about our city? On Earth Day, a couple of days ago, New York City Mayor publicly announced a truly promising environmental plan. New York City aims to cut waste 90%. I was literally thrilled by the news. How could I not be? Until I read the deadline, 2030, which means 15 years from now. I still want to thank the mayor for addressing such a crucial point. His plan is brave and ambitious, and I know that sometimes changes can be slow. But do we need 15 years to make this change? More than anything, do we have 15 years? Can the Earth sustain 15 more years of this type of economy? If you have diabetes, can you eat sweets for 15 more years? If you have skin cancer, can you sunbathe for 15 more years? Unfortunately, we might not have 15 more years. This is vital. This is our legacy to the future, to the planet, to history, to Hearthstone, to non-human species, to our progenies, to us, to our health, to our survival. Everything is connected. This damage balance is directly affecting human well-being. An example can be seen in the alarming global rise on cancer rates. And actually, 15 years, exactly by 2030, the cancer is supposed to be 15% for men and 35% for women. So there is, cancer rates are definitely growing exponentially. So my dermatologist, who is in her 50s, told me that she's seen on very young children specific types of skin cancer, which until 15 years ago, she would only see in her senior patients. The cause? The ozone hole and the exposure to ultraviolet radiation on the skin. This is the type of change she's witnessed in 15 years. 15 years were crucial in the worsening of the non-reversible condition. And there is no way back. We need to switch episteme right now. Because we can. Because we want. Because there is no tomorrow. We are talking today about one of the most important challenges we are currently facing as a species, as individuals, as moral beings who care about the future, as selfish beings who are worried about our own survival. Because we know that the future is already present. It is here, now, in our acts, in our visions, in our behaviors, in what we eat, and what we dream, in our words, in our dreams, in our actions, in our thoughts, our post-human future. I saw changes happening faster than I could ever dream of. I saw the people in the Italian city of Turin learning very quickly how to bring their own plastic bags once the supermarkets started to charge for them. Solutions are there, if you want to find them. In Norway, for instance, more than 90% of all recyclable bottles return into the deposit and recycling system. People receive around 30 cents for cans, glass or plastic bottles over half a liter. And see, we cannot only care, we cannot only take care of the symptoms. We also need to take care of the cause. We need to be aware of our anthropocentric biases in the way we look at the world, in the way we teach at school, at university, at religious centers, in the sports, in the media, in the streets, at work, in the way we talk to our children, to our parents, to our friends, and to our families. It's all of us who are making this paradigm shift. Existence is entangled, related, symbiotic. Posthumanism must happen now, and it is already happening. And remember, you are in charge of existence. We are in charge of existence. Each of our actions resonates in the dynamic texture of space-time. We are making the change right now. And its wave is going to reach the future. 15 years from now, we will meet again here at the party of the future and celebrate the post-human era. And now the future is not made in our hands anymore, because we are enacting our paradigm shift. Because we are now envisioning, realizing, acting. Because we are now creating our personal, social, and existential changes. Right now, the future is here, in this room, in our hands, in our words, in our visions, in our actions and reactions. This is the moment of creation, and nothing will ever be the same.